Hey guys, and welcome to Neuroscience for Musicians. This is a series of live online presentations adapted for YouTube that examines different musical topics with the help of modern scientific research. The goal of this series is to provide you with a deeper, neurologically based understanding of music, no matter what level of musician you might be. Music has historically been a not very well understood part of the human psyche, and we've been trying to understand it for thousands of years. Pythagoras, back in 500 BC, was the first to discover that intervals in Western music follow rules of simple ratios. Music was thought to be a divine art, the result of the gods. We now believe music to be part of the human experience. We now have the tools, most notably fMRI, functional magnetic resonance imaging, to locate specific areas of the brain that are activated when listening to or when playing music. This helps us understand exactly why we feel the way we do when we hear music. First, we're going to cover the basics of sound perception, how we hear sound. And then we'll take a look at the different areas of the brain involved in music processing. Spoiler alert, music processing takes place all over the brain, both hemispheres, in different lobes, different areas, and through different pathways. Next, we're going to take a look at the basic building blocks of music, namely pitch, loudness, rhythm, and timbre. All music so far discovered created by humans is based on pitch contrasts. This is what makes up melody, intervals, and harmony. Music contains dynamics that provide energy contrasts, variations, and loudness. Music is made up of sounds arranged in time. Each of these sounds has a placement and a duration. This is known as rhythm. Lastly, all sounds have distinct characteristic identities that separate them from each other. This is what separates the sound of a violin from that of a trumpet or from that of a human voice. This is known as timbre. If you're a musician and you don't yet think about music in terms of these elements, give it a try. We're going to take a look at each of these topics individually, how they exist in the real world, how we process them neurologically, how we perceive them psychologically, and how we, as musicians, can utilize each of these elements in our music. After this, who knows? We'll take a look at how the brains of musicians differ from those of non-musicians. We'll take a look at some musical functions, such as harmony and melody. We'll take a look at how music functions as a language. And eventually, the end goal of this series is to understand creativity. How are we able to improvise, freestyle, create music in real time? We'll need to build up our understanding in order to reach that point. Music neuroscience is a relatively new field, only about 30 years old, and yet there are already thousands of papers published, studies that examine different musical aspects and how they work in different contexts. There's new research being published every day. The good news for you guys is that you won't have to dig through all those papers. I'll do that for you. All you need to do is hit that subscribe button and follow along as we explore the complex, creative, and scientific world of music neuroscience. If you have any topics you'd like for us to cover or any burning questions you want answered, drop them in the comment section below. My team at the Johns Hopkins Center for Music and Medicine will work hard to get your questions answered as quickly and as accurately as possible. I hope you enjoy the series and learn something from it that will help you create, perform, or just enjoy music. This series is designed so that you'll need very little prerequisite neurological knowledge. The following section will provide you with all the basic information you will need to follow along. The brain is a highly structured organ that localizes processing of different functions to different areas. Auditory stimulus is primarily processed here in the temporal lobe. Visual stimulus is processed here in the occipital lobe. Tactile sensory information is processed in the parietal lobe, and motor functions, as well as executive functions like planning and attention, are processed in the frontal lobe. These are the four main lobes of the cerebral cortex. Emotion is processed in the center of the brain, in a region collectively known as the limbic system. Also in the brain are some important structures, including the thalamus, which relays sensory information throughout the brain, the basal ganglia, which is involved in reward processing and movement, the brainstem, which carries signals to and from the brain, and the cerebellum, which is involved in coordinated movement. The orientation of the brain is with the frontal lobe towards the front of your head and the occipital lobe towards the back. Neuroscience uses specific terminology to indicate directions. The top and bottom are the dorsal and ventral sides, and the front and back are called the rostral and caudal sides. Towards the sides is referred to as lateral, and towards the center is referred to as medial. So when you hear a section referred to as dorsolateral, that means towards the top and towards the side of the brain. We'll be looking at the brain from the side, a lateral view, and through cross sections, vertically along the midline, a sagittal section, as well as a vertical side-to-side cross section, a coronal section. The brain is made up of neurons, which are made up of a cell body, dendrites, and axons. The dendrites receive the signal, the cell body determines whether or not to release the signal, and if it's triggered, will send a one-way signal down the length of the axon to the next neuron. Neurons can work in groups, with collections of cell bodies in one area and axons leading off together. The cluster of cell bodies is a nucleus or a ganglion, and the collection of axons is a tract. In this series, we'll represent a cell body like this as a circle and an axon like this as a line with an open ending, which is where the next cell body will receive the signal. Although I'll only show a single cell and a single axon on diagrams, there will usually be more than one neuron firing at a single time. The brain is made up of gray matter and white matter. Gray matter is made up of mostly cell bodies and are locations where signals are processed. White matter is mostly made up of myelinated axons and are pathways for signals between areas of gray matter. We can monitor the electrical activity of gray and white matter in the brain with tools like EEG and fMRI. fMRI, functional magnetic resonance imaging, was invented in the 1990s and forever changed the field of cognitive neuroscience. The idea is simple. With fMRI, we can determine areas of the brain that have relatively higher or lower oxygen saturation. This is called BOLD imaging, blood oxygenation level dependent imaging. Neurons require oxygen to fire. When an area of the brain is particularly active, the neurons will trigger the surrounding blood vessels to dilate and bring more blood and more oxygen. So an area of the brain that is more active will have more oxygen in the surrounding area than an inactive area. By measuring the relative levels of oxygen in different areas, we indirectly measure the activity of those brain areas. Here's an example of an fMRI study showing the capabilities of this technique. Charles Lim and his team at the University of San Francisco studies creativity and how it's processed in the brain. Here we have an fMRI study of a jazz musician improvising. This fMRI is compared to one of him playing a standard pre-learned melody. The areas in orange are the areas that are relatively oxygenated and therefore more active in the musician improvising compared to him playing a pre-learned piece. The areas in blue are the parts that are relatively deoxygenated and less active when improvising. We can use this image to begin to hypothesize about what areas of the brain are responsible for what functions during freestyle, during improvisation. Now, fMRI is a great tool, but it's not perfect. fMRI reads the relative oxygenation levels, not the direct level of activity. There are actually cases where higher levels of oxygenation reflect lower activity, in the case where neurons are actively inhibiting a pathway. Bold imaging may reflect modulation of a brain signal or alternative pathways. It's not guaranteed that the area determined by bold imaging is directly involved in the activation of a pathway. Finally, bold imaging reflects mass neuronal activation that can drown out smaller, weaker signals that may be involved in pathway activation. So fMRI isn't perfect, but it is the best tool we have. It is great for making hypotheses about the structure and function of the brain, but we will need to use other tools and more research in order to support these hypotheses. We have a long way to go before we fully understand the brain, music or otherwise. This is just the beginning of the journey.